So I'm from SARAID, which is a search and rescue charity. I'm going to take you through a bit about the beginnings of that and whatever else comes up in this presentation. We've got some bits on our deployment to Nepal and some project work that we're going that's going on at the moment. That's right at the very end, so you have to keep yourselves awake. So as I said, Joanna and I have been a member of SARAID for I think 5 years now, 5 or 6, you start losing count, they all merged together, but 5 or 6 years. SARAID started in 1991. It merged from, originally there was International Rescue Corps, which is IRC, I don't know if any of you guys have heard of them. They're another search and rescue charity. And RAPID is also another search and rescue charity. Originally it was just those two and the fire service USAR teams that were in the UK. They are charities as well. I believe International Rescue Corps is still going, but RAPID has now dissolved and reformed as something else. I'm not entirely sure about what happened there, but anyway. Members from those two came together and made SARAID in 1991 because they weren't happy with the way that those two were run. These two have previously deployed to Mexico City and Armenia, which is where all of this came about. There were some problems with the Armenian earthquake and how it was coordinated, so that birthed INSARAG. You guys know of INSARAG? No? Okay, we'll go into that. So this all came out of Armenia and it all formed in 1991. So let's see what we've got. So there's INSARAG. So the International Search and Rescue Advisory Group is part of the United Nations, OCHA, Department of Office of Coordination of Humanitarian Affairs is a part of the UN. And then a part of OCHA is INSARAG, and INSARAG is what dictates search and rescue internationally. So if you just remove that. That should play. It was written by OCHA and it just takes through some of the stuff. Is there sound on the students?
If she has a little tablet in front of you, it should up the volume.
I'm not sure why that says 2000, So SARAID formed from IRC and Rapid team members to form a new, sparkly, shiny team that was going to do everything right as well. Okay, we're going to take all the bad from IRC and all the bad out of Rapid, we're going to come together and form this new team. The old team members that originated from these two teams were operational, they were experienced, they've been on deployments with these two previous teams, so SARAID really was ready and ready to go. I wasn't one of those, I'm not out. So, SARAID as it stands today consists of 18 operational members from a whole vast variety of occupations. Anybody can join SARAID, there is no prerequisite like there is for some of the other charities. Okay. We've even got a lorry driver, he's fantastic on the tools, but we have emergency planners, fire and police officers, the whole lot. Freelance, PR, everything and anything is welcome in SARAID because everybody has skills and those skills can be used for anything, whether it's coordinating in the UK, coordinating in country, whether it's actually using the power tools, whether it's with dogs or working with other people, liaison, anything and everything. So it really is an open organisation. So out of those guys, we've got three medics who we take with us. They are, their main priority is to look after the team members if we hurt ourselves. Obviously, if there is a casualty or a victim of the disaster, they will help them out medically as well. But we are not a medical team. We do not go out there to treat the dying and the injured. We will do if it comes in the line of our duty, of course we will, but we're not out there to set up a field hospital or anything like that. Our work is we get them out, we send them to the right place to make sure that they can get that medical treatment. Two engineers, Mark and Josh, are absolutely fantastic. They tell us whether we're allowed to go in there, what we're allowed to smash holes in, and what we're absolutely not allowed to touch. We do give them bits every now and again, but it's quite funny to watch. So that's our engineers and three USAR technicians. I am one of those, been operational for 3.5 years. We'll go into the training package in a minute. But USAR technicians, we do everything. We do the listening, we do the searching, we do the rescuing, we do primary first aid if they need it in the hold. We don't have to send our medics in because if we lose them, then who's going to look after us? So we are first aid trained as well. So this is the ugly group of us that went out to Nepal. Some nice looking people on there, aren't they? Wonderful. That's who you're going to be stuck in holes with. Aren't they wonderful? There we go. So we've got 18 non-USAR operations, so haven't passed their training yet, haven't passed their assessment week. They are in their in the process of training and hopefully sooner rather than later they'll be all passed and on the ops list as well. Okay, one of our guys who's not passed actually came out to Nepal with us, which is Adam. I don't think he's on there actually, I think he's missing. So Adam came out with us, he's not operationally trained, he can't do any USAR stuff, but he was fantastic in base camp looking after us, so as soon as we got back he had a meal ready, he logs all the equipment coming in and out, he logs all the radio calls, he sends our reports, our daily reports back to the UCC, which is the Urban Search and Rescue Coordination Centre, which I'll tell you about, and just keeps that information flow going. So although it does take about 18 months to get fully operational in SARAID, you can be a very valuable member of the team for it. Okay, so 11 waiting to do their selection team, so that's on top of that 18 that are on the waiting list. So this is how you join if you did wish to do so. I think this is more of a PR, I did explain in an information one. We won't worry too much about that. Okay, so SARAID standards. This is really important to me. I'm the coordination specialist for SARAID. So when we go out in Nepal, I was in the tent with all the maps and the radios and all the phone numbers for the teams and phone number for Lima. Do you know who Lima is? Don't you? Please tell me you do. Lima is the local emergency management agency, so it's the government that owns the disaster. when a country is affected by anything, say it be a tsunami, an earthquake, hurricane, anything at all, that disaster belongs to the country. We cannot go unless they ask us to go. If we go without them asking, then it can be considered an invasion. It's we have taken it upon ourselves to go and tell a country that they need help when they haven't asked for it, and that is not on at all. So we have to sit and wait to be asked. We have to do a request for assistance is the official term. In Nepal, that took 28 hours to get back. So it is a bit of a difficult situation because that's 24 hours that we've got less to rescue. So in regards to the SARAID standards, they all have bits and pieces like this. I've just realised I didn't bring my little notepad. You can get on Amazon, there's like a USAR ops guide. It's about the size of my hand, waterproof paper, and it takes you through all of the shoring regulations, how to do shoring, nail patterns, breaching and breaking, all the technical stuff, and you can get that anywhere online. And it is all set out to the SARAID standards. It's all researched, it's proven to work, it is the best way to do it. And if we go out and see a shore in Nepal or Haiti or wherever, it will all be set out exactly the same because that is the way that works and we all follow these guidelines. Okay? So there are guidelines referring to all of those. We won't go through them too much. So D4H is how we as a team organise ourselves. These are all of the operational members. On this side, the list does go down, and then below that are the non-ops members. The green tick is that we are available. So there's me, I'm available. And at the top, so 18 members on call. That's who's available. If I'm going on holiday for a week, I'll put it on there and say, I'm not available for this week, I'll be funding myself, you'll have to deal without me. We also have in there tags on people who are engineers. We have to take an engineer with us. We wouldn't go without an engineer. These buildings are unstable and we need somebody to say that's really not safe to be bashing holes in. We need to put a shore up there. Or yeah, that's fine, go in. You'll be absolutely fine. Okay? So we need this guy. We would never ever go without Mark or Josh, which should be on there somewhere as well. Okay? Our medics are also listed on there. We wouldn't go without them. So this tool helps us decide if we've got the right people available to put a team together. If we have, how many, who are they? All our passport details are on here, so as soon as they pick the team members, somebody can get on the phone to the airline. We don't need to necessarily all be at the same place. They have my passport number, is this, that, the other. It is all on there. All of our training events and fundraising events, anything that we do as a team is all listed. We can put whether we're attending or not, and all of the latest bits and pieces that we've done, our debriefs go on there, so if there's any lessons to be learned, it will be on here. This is really the sort of centre of our team, and it is D4H. Okay. Most of our training is down in Bristol. It is full on. We start about 10 o'clock on a Friday night and we do not finish until about 12 o'clock on a Sunday. We normally get about 4 hours sleep a night while we're there. Because we only train once a month, we need to pack in as much as we can in that time. So that is the reason why we don't sleep. Okay. Okay, so have you guys done about OSOC at all? Heard of it? No? Okay. When a disaster happens, you get a request for assistance, you then fly out. You get to, in Haiti, it was the main international airport. At the main international airport, you need to have somebody coordinating what is going on. So, virtual OSOC is like our D4H, but for the United Nations. So all the search and rescue teams are on there. They say whether they're going to turn up, if they are, what flight they're on, what time they're going to arrive. You have a team of fact sheets, which you fill in all the details, which say how many people you've got, how many dogs you've got, how much food you've brought with you. When we fly abroad, we take absolutely everything. We take all the food we're going to eat for the whole deployment, which we say a maximum of 14 days. And we also take water. That's so that we have no burden on the local community whatsoever. We don't want to be taking their food, we do not want to be taking their wood. Okay? If it is absolutely freezing cold, we will not take their wood to build a fire. It's their wood, that is somebody's house. And whether they be dead or alive, it's not ours and we will not take it. Okay? So we take everything out with us. And that is an indirect standard, every search and rescue team does that. So that all that information we'll put on virtual.soc, which is just an online coordination platform. Once you get to the actual airport, you need a physical person there coordinating all of this stuff. Okay, so they'll be drawing stuff off of virtual.soc saying, right, we've got four teams arriving on this flight and we need somewhere for all of their kit to go. We need somewhere for all of the people to be held until we've got somewhere to take them, and I need this many trucks to get them to where they're going to go. Where they're going to go is going to be this place over here. Okay, so this is the RDC, which is up the top there. Okay, so when an international search and rescue team arrives at the first place, they report to the RDC. The RDC is usually set up by the first search and rescue team on site. In Haiti, that was SARAID. Got some pictures coming up of the RDC that they set up out in Haiti. Once the RDC is set up, either the rest of that team or the next team that can do so will set up the OSOC, which is, as it says, on-site operations and coordination center. That is the place where it all happens. That is the place where everything is coordinated from. They'll talk to Lima, the local emergency management authority, and they'll also talk to the USAR teams. Now this has slightly changed in that now, with the new guidelines in 2014, there's the UCC should be in there, which is the Urban Search and Rescue Coordination Centre. They will directly coordinate the USAR teams instead of OSOC doing it. OSOC will be coordinating the FMTs, which is the something medical teams. There'll be offsets like field hospitals and bits. There's lots of organisations that will eventually come in. Search and rescue is the first one. They're the acute reaction to the disaster. And then after that, you get Save the Children, Oxfam, and the Blue Rose Guards. They'll be dealing with those guys, coordinating all of that. And the UCC will be coordinating the search and rescue. Okay. So the Lima local teams and resources, that could be military, it could be their fire service, it could be their ambulance service. Obviously they need to be kept in the loop because there's no good those doing what they want to do and the search and rescue teams doing what they want to do and the field hospitals doing what they want to do. It all has to be coordinated so that it's all effective and it happens quickly and we get the best outcome for everybody, which is of course saving lives. Yeah. So that's a little bit about the RDC. Just a couple of things that, well, quite a few things that need to be thought about for the RDC. Don't worry too much about this. I actually run a 4-day course on the RDC, so don't worry about that, alright? It's just a overview that we're looking for today. So this is actually a training exercise for an RDC. It is basically, RDC stands for Reception and Departure Centre. So it is basically a reception desk for USAR teams. So this is our reception desk. These are our guys here managing the RDC and they'll be taking the information and saying, okay, we've got a heavy team with 64 people and 3 tonnes of equipment. You're not going to send them to search a terrace house. Just lay and make it better. As long as we're together, does it matter where we go? So when I'm ready to be bolder and my cuts out, I feel the time. Comfort will rest on my shoulder, not bury my future behind. I'll always keep you with me, you'll be always on my mind. But there's a shining in the shadows, now never know. They say all is well. you go. That was Nepal. The guys in the yellow were on At File, which is another NGO from Germany. We met them on a flight from New Delhi to Kathmandu. They are quite a large team, but for some reason I only had, I think, two dogs, two dog handlers, and about four other guys. There was only six of them, plus the two dogs, that went out to Nepal. So they were really just a search capacity. They didn't have any rescue capacity with them. So SARAID teamed up with them from the get-go. We set up the base camp together. This was the TP-shaped tent. I was very jealous. And we stuck together through the whole deployment. We had an excellent working relationship through that, and some ongoing work with them as well. We're going to go out to Germany in January to do some training in the coordination stuff. So that was the guys in yellow. Did you see the aeroplane with the big circles? While we actually got stuck in New Delhi, there were still aftershocks going on, so the airport was closed for quite a while in Kathmandu. So no planes could take off. Planes are not, by international law, allowed to take off unless they've got a safe place to land. And because Kathmandu airport was closed, they didn't have that, so they weren't allowed to take off for quite a while. When we did finally manage to get a plane, as you can see, it was pretty empty, not that many people out to Nepal then. So we had the plane, we were on our way, and then halfway over, it was an hour's flight. Before that, we sat on the runway in the plane, all loaded, ready to go for about 2.5 hours. They actually served us an in-flight meal on the tarmac, which was quite unusual. Again, in the time between us being loaded onto the plane and the plane taking off, there had been another aftershock. Every aftershock, the whole runway had to be surveyed just to make sure that it was still working and planes could use it. We then took off about halfway into the flight. It was only supposed to be an hour. Another aftershock, so of course the runway then had to be surveyed again, which is all of the circles. By this time, all of the planes that were ready and waiting to take off, like we were, had all taken off at the same time. There was, I think, a queue of about 50 planes over Kathmandu. Now, Kathmandu is a single runway airport. There is parking for six aeroplanes and obviously one taxi. That is it. If you're not one of those six, you are having to wait, I'm afraid. So until something takes off, nothing else can land, basically. So for that hour flight took about 3.5-4 hours, I think, just circling round and round.
Do you know where you could have got a helicopter instead?
Helicopters don't fly that far. They don't carry enough fuel. There were 16 of us, I think. There were 16 of us, and we had a ton and a half of equipment. So yeah, helicopters are brilliant for smaller stuff, but for that and that distance, we wouldn't have been able to get anything. So we landed in Kathmandu in the middle of the night. Had to go through immigration, do all our visas. Thankfully they waived our visa, which was excellent because we didn't have to pay the money for it, and of course we didn't have to wait a week for them to sign it and send it back, so that's pretty good. As we were walking through the airport, the floor is all crunched up, the walls have got cracks in them, and it wasn't really the kind of place that you wanted. You felt like staying in for any period of time, and you know what airports are like. So we got round to the baggage reclaim. Ours came through just as everybody else's did. So you have all the general public grabbing their suitcases, you have us grabbing these great big orange boxes and cardboard boxes full of our ration packs and all sorts of search cans, absolutely everything, and trying to bung them onto them shopping trolley type things, you know, at the airport. Of course, there was only 16 of us, and I think our kit took up about 24 shopping trolleys. So it's a bit of a, right, I'll move it that far, you wait with that one, I'll get another one, you wait with that one. So that's why we have to move it. can't leave anything unattended at any time. It is very expensive equipment. We do rely on public donations, and if we go losing on the market, it's not very good. On top of that, of course, most important thing is if we lose our kit in the airport going out, we can't do anything when we get there. So it is really important that we look on. I've got the military bus eventually. We were stuck in the airport for a number of hours while the RDC tried to get us some transport. We were, I think, the third team in country to here. So it took 54 hours from the earthquake for us to actually get to Kathmandu. That is a long time. It was a very, very long time, but we were the third team out there. There were teams that didn't arrive until day four. That is how hectic it can be. And they left us at the same time as us. So, getting out there is really the main issue. Okay. So we got our military truck round to the base of operations. There were two other teams set up there already. The Dutch team, which our government team, absolutely enormous base camp. They had the lot. They had tier and showers, everything. The Swiss team, I believe, which had three tiny little tents, and that was about it. And then us guys. And then after that, base camp just exploded with tents and all sorts. I can't remember exactly how many teams were in base camp. I think there were about 68 teams altogether that deployed, but not all of those were in that base camp because they just literally didn't fit. Base camp was next to the runway, which is pretty amazing. At 4 o'clock in the morning when you get a military flight landing, it literally does sound like it's coming over the side of the tent. I did jump out and have a look just to make sure it wasn't a couple of times. So not conducive for a great night's sleep, but there we go. So there we go. Natural disasters such as earthquakes usually result in dramatic peak in mortality. So 72 hours is the main sort of window for survival. Obviously, it took us 54 to get there. It then took till the next morning till we got to the team leaders' briefings, till we got our task ins. That meant we could go out and start searching. So, as you can imagine, that 72 hour window is getting smaller and smaller and smaller as time goes on. The curve for survival is pretty much like that. There have been people pulled out alive. I think in Haiti someone managed to survive something like 30 days being trapped. What they forget to tell you is that they were trapped in a supermarket. So, good for them. But really up to 7 days. 7 days is the maximum if you're young, fit, healthy, and you know how to survive. But other than that, it is about 72 hours. So it is really important that we get there as quickly as we can. So those 24 hours it took to get our request for assistance really, really was far too long. It took 24 hours out of us getting there, and it took 24 hours out of that 72 hours to find people.
What was the reason for such a long wait in the
As soon as an earthquake happens, to a request for assistance is a very serious thing. In, I don't know what year it was, but in, I think it was Indonesia, there was an earthquake. They requested assistance, it wasn't needed. So a lot of charities and NGOs sent their teams out, and government organisations as well sent their teams out. They all arrived and there was absolutely no need for them, and it was a vast waste of resources. Obviously on the flip side of that, if they need it and they don't request for assistance, that is even worse as far as I'm concerned. But there is, they do like to err a bit on the side of caution and make sure that they do really need the help. In an earthquake, I mean, I'm sure you can imagine the first people you would be calling would be your family. You'd be making sure that they're alright. If you can't get through, you'd be around their house. If you're able, if you can get there, if the roads are clear. If you can't get there, you're going to spend extra time looking for your family. I mean, anybody would. The last thing that you're going to do is call into work. So, oh yeah, I'm here now to do that risk assessment for you to make sure that that school's still safe. Yeah. So, At the end of the day, you can have all the policies and procedures, but you are dealing with human beings, and human beings have feelings, they have families, and of course they're going to want to make sure that they're okay. So, once heard, what's that guy's name? You know the geography guy that does the Scottish, does all the geography programs?
Ian Stewart. Ian Stewart.
That's it, that's the guy. He did a talk actually down here a couple of years ago. And he said, earthquakes don't kill people, buildings do. And it's absolutely true. 75% of all deaths are from buildings. Glass is a major killer in earthquakes. All these lovely, beautiful glass buildings that you see. When glass breaks and falls, it falls like a feather, like a sheet of paper. And the first thing you do in an earthquake is right outside, which is where all of these feathers of glass are, which is not very nice. So that's some of the statistics for you guys about being trapped in an earthquake. So 50% of victims are found at or near the surface. They don't need USAR. They are found in the first couple of hours by the local people, their next door neighbours, the fire service, the police, some guy from up the road. They are found in the first couple of hours, if not days. The next lot, 35%. Maybe a bit more specialist skills or a bit more daring, perhaps. People that is getting those guys out, maybe have to move some rubble and bits and pieces like that. But those 35% do not really need the kind of skills that USAR technicians have. We are here for those 15%. That's what USAR is for. We don't worry about the 50%. They'll be out, up and about and gone before we even probably on the plane. The next 35%, most of them will be out as well. It's that 15% that we're after. That is what we go for. So when you hear, I think it was Katie, was 126, 156 on this, one of the previous slides, were rescued by international search and rescue teams. That is that 15%. So I know that 220,000 people died in Haiti, so 100 and something is not a lot of people, really, is it? But that's that 15%. Okay, so this is our Steve, one of our other medics. He's been out to Nepal since the earthquake. He is doing another project that has come about since Nepalese earthquake. He's going out and training groups of young guys out in and girls out in Nepal, and they are going to go out and train locals in basic search and rescue skills so they can be even more effective at getting that 35%. They won't be trained to the level that they can get the 15, that's what the international search and rescue community is going to do. They won't ever be trained to do that because they won't have the skills, they won't have the equipment, they won't have the continuity of training, they won't be able to keep their skills levels up. So it's not possible to expect them to be able to do it. But we are going to be training them for that magic 35% level. So this is his training centre, right in the Nepalese mountain ranges. His agenda and training, and this is some of the guys who were training. So there were about five or six delegates that were assigned an area, a district of Nepal. They'll be going out there and they'll be going around the villages training the village people how to do basic search and rescue. Some of the sexualisation mapping they were practicing. Mapping, hand-drawn maps is actually a really important part. Maps are pretty hard to come by until Map Action rock up and have their mapping kit and know-how. Maps are really, really scarce. If we We can't print them off unless we take a printer with us. We do take a printer with us, but on an A4 printer, that's how much you can see on an A4 map. So, and they change in, places change in disasters. So the OS type maps that you can get readily available sometimes aren't always that useful. So hand mapping is very important. And some techniques for rescue, for quick casualty removal. Obviously, if he's got no upper back or no back pain, and he's in a bit of a tight squeeze, you can get him out like that. We have stretches and bits and pieces that we put people on, so this really is basic no kit needed type of training. And that is all of them, I think. I think this is another video. Yeah, so a lot of this is about positive building in the community. You've got your will, so the mitigation, response, recovery, preparedness, yep. So this is, it's partly recovery, because it's empowering these people to say yes, we've had this earthquake, but actually, you know what, we're not going to lay down and just let this happen again. We're going to learn something, we're going to go out, we're going to do something about this. And it's also about preparedness, because we're giving these people the skills to actually respond themselves, and that is really important. We this is all about, and your degree, it's all about helping people, and it's all about making sure that lives aren't lost. But one of the most important things in helping people is in empowering them to help themselves. You can spoon feed somebody, but if you teach somebody to use a knife and fork themselves, they can feed themselves forever, they don't need you. And that is important. And you need to be able to let go and say, you know what, we've done everything we can for you. You are ready to go and face the big wide world. So that is what this is about. And these groups of people will be going out to the local community and they'll be passing that information on as well. And most importantly, it will be Nepalese to Nepalese. It won't be some outsider, some random person coming and saying, this is what you need to do and this is the way you need to do it. It will be somebody, one of their peers, one of their people, their own people saying, look, this is the information I've got and this is how we can use it and we can help ourselves in the future, which is the main aim for all of them. So these are the groups of guys and their first stops in Nepal. They will be touring around and teaching lots of places within those districts, and then they'll be moving on to other districts as well. I believe we are due to be going out there again. This was done September, so very quickly after the opening in the general sense of how long it takes to get something like this organised. And about 6 months after that, so early next year, somebody will be going out there again just to make sure that they're all okay, that their skills are still up to date, and just to let them know that we're still here, and if you need us, if you need more training, this is your opportunity to get that. I think this is some more photos from them. So Barefoot Clinics is another project out in Nepal, and they are, this is centred all around Nepalese monasteries. Now in each district there is like a head monastery, and they train the other monasteries within the district, and they go all over. I mean, some of these places it's a 6-hour trek to get to some of these places. There are no roads there, they just aren't roads. It is just a case of you have to walk 6 hours to get there. And these, the monks, they do that quite regularly. So it was thought that as these monks have this network and they know how to get to these places, they're fantastic in navigating their way through all of these mountain passes, they'd be excellent for passing on knowledge and skills as well. They have been undertaking some training in acupuncture for pain relief, which they'll be going to do whatever they want to do with that. The guys who were training them, I can't remember who it was, but they approached SARAID and asked us if we could be involved as well on the USAR front. So the monks will be being trained in emergency first aid. They will also be being trained in some basic search and rescue as well. So in line and hail, which is basically a human version of the Delta, which is the census. So you'll have people there listening. And there's on a scale of 1 to 5, how loud is yours, if you can hear something, and then you go down like that. So so line and hail is like a human version of that. They'll also be being trained, I think, in some basic shoring as well, just to make buildings slightly safer than if it wasn't there at all. And some other bits and pieces as well. So triage, building triage, they were changing that too. We have a specific sort of mind map of how you do that, whether it's got known people, known casualties, yes or no, and go through on the survivors and the voids. And it'll go through and it'll give you a triage of how important that building is to search. If there's nobody in it, there's no survivors and voids, it'll be the lowest priority, which I think is F. It'll be right down the bottom. people shouting, and there are survivable voids, that would be an A because you can get in there quickly and there are difficult people. So they'll be trained in that as well. Cribbing theory, which is lifting heavy chunks of concrete up on wood very slowly, very carefully. It's quite safe, quite easy to do, and you don't need that much. You don't need that many tools or equipment to do it, so it's good for those guys. So that is the barefoot clinics. There you go. So I think that is pretty much it for the slides. Is there anything that anybody wants to know any more about in particular, whether that be...
What would happen if, like, say for two countries that needed assistance at the same time, would you like split up? Or would
the
you
team?
Or would you just see which one needs most assistance, or what would happen?
I don't think it has happened that I'm aware of. If it were to happen, we wouldn't split the team. We'd be one team. At the moment, we have a team of 18 people that are operational. Most of the time, at least one of those is unavailable for whatever reason, be that work or whatever. So to split that team, we wouldn't really be effective use staff wise. We can still do reconnaissance, we can do reconnaissance in draft 2 or 4, or we can send some people out to do OSOP, the coordination type stuff. But no, we probably wouldn't split the team. What would happen, I imagine, in a case like that would be the UN would take the lead. It depends on where they were as well. If they were opposite sides of the world, you'd have all the teams from that side going to that one, and all the teams from this side going to this one. So, if you remember the Christchurch earthquake? So, they did ask for assistance, but they didn't ask for sort of international everybody help. They asked specifically for teams from Australia, I think some Japanese teams possibly went, and China, which are all pretty close to New Zealand, so it's like a regional coordination type response as well. Alright, so that would probably be what would happen.
Okay.
Yeah.
Where did you get the statistics from with the 50%, 30%, 35%, 15%?
I got them from that slide. I don't know. Steve actually wrote this PowerPoint. The guy who done the training, which is quite a lot of, which is now quite a lot of that. No, he hasn't put that on there, has he? I don't know, but I can ask him, and if I take your email, I'll is that alright?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. We get any email questions from anybody?
What advice? Oh, sorry. What advice do you give to people like us who need to look for jobs? Like, how do you get into the industry? What was your route?
So, when I graduated in 2009, it was really quite barren there. There were no jobs at all. I'd say with this kind of degree, the only thing you're going to get paid to do in the UK is emergency planning or something in the private sector. Most of the private sector jobs want previous experience, which is obviously catch 22, very frustrating. I would say if you are able to do so, go abroad, because, you know, we don't want the earthquakes to come to us, obviously, or any of the other disasters. Go to them. Go out. Are you guys doing Australia this year?
No,
South Africa. South Africa. Wow. Okay. Well, get contacts. You're going to be meeting so many people over there. Get contacts. And anywhere you go, if you're going to, going to Tenerife again or wherever, just get those contacts. And even if you don't want to move there forever, a year of getting experience would just do so much for you. UK-wise, it is just emergency planning, paid sense of it. SARAID is volunteers. If you want to do USAR paid, the only way to do that is fire service. You have to do 2 years retained, followed by 2 years full-time before they'll even consider you for USAR. So if it's something you want to do, you really need to commit, and there will be hard times. okay?
Yeah, it's perfect.
Oh,
sorry,
do you
want to
answer
the question?
Any more?
Okay. I was
going to
ask, what's your day job?
My day job?
Yeah.
I actually work for Border Force over in Calais.
Alright.
Yeah, so I go from one disaster zone to another, just generally. Okay, but we have people from all sorts of units, circuit rigger, and guys that put the tents up at circuses. Yeah, and it's great for the road work though.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we've got a guy who does stunts. He does all the safety stuff, the stunts and things. So he's great for rope work and swift water rescue and all sorts of things. Thank you. You remind me of me, how'd you go? Any other questions? Anything? I'm not telling you what kind of person.